Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
It's a cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
We have the tools, we have the talent. It's Miller time.
I said empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits. And not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane. Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
It's showtime.
Welcome to Comic Book Radio. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti. This is episode 57. My guest tonight is Matt Moylan of Udon Entertainment. He's a director of publishing over there. I talked to Matt a few years ago, and it's been too long. And now he's back, and we'll be catching up for a little bit, but we'll also be talking about all kinds of great stuff going on over there at Udon. And also, I want to pick Matt's brains in regard to how everything is going in the state of the comic industry and whatnot, according to him. We hear enough about my thoughts. I want to hear about his thoughts. Before we get started, I want to talk to you guys in the chat. We got Mark here. What's up, Mark? This is Matt's great on Twitter, and Udon is a fun publisher. There you go. Norin Rad's here too. Says, I've been collecting Udon from the start. Awesome books, and I love the Capcom characters. Jaded One, what's up, Jaded One? Hope you're doing well. We got Arnaud Arras here too. What's up, Arnaud? Jeff Kimbler in the chat. Hey, Jeff, hope you're doing well. Carl Lawrence is here too. What's up, Carl? Brian Suddenly Old in the chat too. What's up, Brian? And hello, Ross Wolf. Hope you're doing well. Says, I've been waiting for this episode. Do you mean just like today, or you've been waiting like to see us talk again? Because we did talk years ago. Good grief. I can't remember how long. 3? 4? Maybe it's best that I just ask Matt himself.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey, Matt. How long has it been? Has it been 3 or 4 years?
I don't know. It might have been, I think it was pre-pandemic.
Right?
Or might have been even in the middle of it. I don't know. At least in the middle of it or earlier.
Holy but, smokes. Yeah. Man, oh man. It's been a while, but I'm glad you're on the show now, and it's good to see that things are still doing well for Udon, correct?
Yeah, I mean, we've got a few different divisions at the company. Like, we publish art books, mostly video game art books. We publish manga from Japan. And we publish original comics and a few graphic novels. And we've also got a merch business doing like pins and shirts and things
nice.
Like that. And everything's doing good right now. We kind of have all those divisions because they tend to go
that
up and down. But
inflection is like, yeah, you know, I feel you.
it's good that everything's going good right now. But if something falters, we've got all these other sections of the company.
Good.
But
that's
great, man. Comics, probably doing more comics than we have for like 10 years, like the last decade, like
nice
at the moment. just because we've hit on this great formula that works for us. And yeah, we'll probably like a lot for us is like we did like a dozen issues this year, and we'll do a dozen issues next year, maybe more. But yeah, things are going great.
Very nice, man. Is it a secret formula, or can you share?
No, it's not that. I mean, so what works for us is we have three main channels that we sell, that we make money off comics. Let's say that. So we sell through the direct market through Diamond to comic shops, and we also do retailer exclusive variants. So we'll do different amounts each issue, but sell to a specific retailer, and they'll sell just their own cover themselves. And we also sell through our own website, udonstore.com. And nice. The Udon Store is where we make the most money. We probably, most issues we have paid for, like we'll take pre-orders about the same day that the book is sort of, not announced, but it appears in Diamond Previews. So we'll take pre-orders on our website, and we'll have a couple exclusive covers for our website, and we'll probably pay for the creative and the printing in the first week of the pre-orders. And then from there, just the retailer variants and the direct market sales and any other store sales are like our profit.
That's fantastic, man.
But yeah, so our basic formula is that most issues have four direct market covers. Two of them are just regular covers, like an A and a B, two different artists. The third cover, which we do most of the time, not all the time, but most of the time, is a blank sketch cover. And I thought by now that people would be sick of another blank sketch cover that says Street Fighter on it, but they keep selling. So I guess people missed the last one. But and then
I thought that fad kind of would have ended too. And then we tried it out anyway, just because out of pure, I don't know, selfishness to want to see a sketch cover with Alterna stuff. And then people really like the ones we put out. So I figured we'll keep doing them. And they're very popular.
Yeah. Especially if you've got a property that's associated with artwork, like Street Fighter is. And then our fourth direct market cover is an incentive, and we keep our incentive low, like 5 to 1. So that we're just hoping, you know, maybe we'll order an extra one. And it doesn't seem like those copies are sitting on the shelves, because we always do a 15-20% overprint, and that always sells out. Mm-hmm. So that's our direct market strategy. And then add to that, on our website, we'll have two exclusive covers, like usually a $20 unlimited cover and a $50 limited cover. That's limited to, like, when we started out, we did like 100, but there was more demand. So now we do 250, and that seems to be about the right amount. They all sell out sometimes really quickly, sometimes after a few weeks or a few months. But so that's our main strategy, and it works. It's not super scalable. We couldn't do like 4 Street Fighter comics a month and do this, because, you know, who's going to buy 4 $50 covers in a month? but no, it works good. And there's two kind of customers. There's definitely readers and collectors. I've used this comparison before. Like, do you remember the Futurama episode where they're in the art gallery and all the paintings in the future are on like fat guys' bellies? They're just like, oh, that's just what people want in the future. And for some reason right now, people want to collect art that's on the cover of a comic. Even though they might not necessarily want to read it, they just want to collect art on the cover of a comic.
That's kind of, I think, always been that way. I think there's a lot of people out there. I mean, I've been guilty of that a couple times, where I've collected specifically because I was like, that cover's great, you know, and I don't even really read that series, but I love the cover or the artist doing it or something. And I kind of flip through the book, but I'm like, I don't think I'm going to really read this one.
Yeah, I used to buy any cover that Joe Mad did, whether it was like some weird Wildstorm book I never heard of or whatever. I'd buy any cover he did. So,
yeah, it's my answer to them not putting out amazing trading card sets the way they used to.
Yeah, that makes it. Yeah, it's true. Man, dude, can you imagine when Jim Lee did his trading card sets, and they're like, "Hey, Jim, you're drawing a monthly comic. You want to draw 120 cards?" Front and back? Like, oh, okay, sure.
Well, God bless him that he did.
Yeah.
Man. Those were the days, though. I love those cards. All that stuff. The Marvel Universe stuff. DC put out some good sets back in the day. There were some good indie sets as well. And then they made trading cards for everything. You know, do you guys do trading cards at all in any capacity?
Yeah, sort of. We haven't done like a traditional paper trading cards, but we do metal cards. They're, I don't have one within reach. They're like, it's like a piece of metal that's, the artwork on it is partly etched and partly a couple ink hits. So black ink and sometimes one or two extra colors. And then with that, with the etching, you can make the whole, so like etching different textures, you can make a cool piece of art. So we've done them like either as a freebie, if you spend so much on the store, you get this metal card. Or if you, and they're real metal. They're not like foil cards, they're like a piece of metal.
Like you could just like, psh,
yeah, yeah. So
kill someone with that.
So yeah, there might have been a free giveaway, or we've sometimes sold them as a set in like a little book, like a set of like all the Shadaloo bosses by these metal cards. So we've done them for different Capcom properties, Mega Man, Street Fighter, Darkstalkers, kind of stuff.
That sounds cool, man. Yeah, I love trading cards, and even, you know, what we're doing here is, where is it? We're bringing, we got these cards, and then we do like the
cool
power sets and whatnot on the back of them. It's so much fun. I love seeing stuff like that. I love that stuff when I was growing up. It really helped me get into the characters and the stories too. But that's great that you're offering something cool like that. I've seen people do metal trading cards, and I'm always like, do you mean just like a metallic finish? But every time I talk to them, it's like what you're saying. It's on actual metal.
Yeah, it's I don't know how they make it. Maybe it's, I don't know if it's all laser etched or if it's some sort of chemical etching. My Eric Co handles most of the metal cards, so I don't know the actual production behind them.
They got to have some weight to them, right?
Yeah. They're he usually will bring them to like the convention himself, like rather than have them shipped or anything. So he's got this chunk of metal in his bag.
That's kind of cool. I got to look into that. I want to see what that's like. I got to get me some metal trading cards. Man, oh man. So has anything substantially changed since the last time that we talked? Let's say it's 2019, was the last time. Has anything really changed in terms of what you guys have been putting out or how you've been doing things over there? I know the world has really changed, so I'm curious if things have changed for you.
It's definitely more. We're doing more right now. 2019, we're probably we did some one shots that year, but we did them. We did a kind of a monthly four issue. It was not like four issues monthly, but they were all separate one shots of Street Fighter. But now we're balanced it out to, we're doing quarterly Street Fighter issues, and we're doing twice a year Darkstalkers issues. We have a free comic book day book every year. We have a swimsuit special every year. This is our eighth year this year doing swimsuit specials, and they're still doing great. And we have a couple this year. We also did a tie into the game, like the new Street Fighter 6 game came out, so we teamed up with Capcom and they drew half the series and we drew half the series. So that was a fun thing, half of a four issue 48 page series that we released weekly.
Wow.
Into comic shops. So that was a little bit crazy. Maybe we won't go that nuts again. So it's like 200 pages in a month that come out. But yeah, we did that, and we also have we just did this, which is it's a comic Capcom hired us to do. So they gave us the basic story, and we, you know, worked it into a comic and stuff, and they gave it away at Evo, which is one of the big video game competition events for fighting games. And they gave it to you if you were registered to be in the tournament at all, or in any upcoming fighting game Capcom tournament.
Oh, wow.
So this is like a regular comic, and now that that convention's done, we're going to release like a mass market version of it in the fall sometime. But so nice. That's something different. So trying some different things, and next year we'll have a similar amount of comics. You know, Street Fighter will stay quarterly, and Darkstalkers twice a year, and we'll have a different miniseries coming out.
Do you guys have like a licensing deal with Capcom in perpetuity?
Well, this is... 2023, next month is our 20th anniversary of the first Street Fighter. Maybe this month, technically. I think they released early in August at conventions, but we've been doing the Street Fighter comics for 20 years.
Wow.
As a licensee, Unbroken, we've gone up and down the amount of comics we've done every year. But I think the only people who have ever had a longer comic license than us was Dark Horse with Star Wars.
Oh wow!
I can't think of anybody else who's had a license for that long.
I was going to maybe put out like Bongo with the Simpsons and things like that.
Oh, maybe. But, yeah, I didn't think of that. It's,
but, I don't
know. Yeah, they're probably pretty close. A little further. Yeah, they don't do it anymore, I don't think, right? I think Bongo's done,
so, yeah. I think they've been done. But yeah, man, that's interesting. I'm so fascinated by it only because it's a road I will never go down. So I'm endlessly fascinated by the concept of licensing the books and doing things like that, because for me it's a different, but maybe it's kind of a similar process in terms of working with creative teams and having their own books and whatnot. But for you guys, where you're doing a licensing of these huge properties, extremely popular between the video games and everything else, I'm always intrigued by that, because I see so many other publishers where they do get the licenses for certain things and it seems like they just mishandle the death out of them. And you guys always do really well with that, you know. Is that because are they giving you some kind of creative freedom? Are they making sure that you guys are, is there a quality control aspect to it?
I think they have a lot of trust in us, but we do definitely go through every issue, like goes through an approval process at Capcom. And because it's a Japanese video game property, kind of the standard for that is that the current producer of the game is also like the brand manager. So they get to decide what gets made and they have to approve everything. So all of our ideas go through the current Street Fighter producer. And he has to go, and he has to also look at the comics in the end to see if like, oh, this is good. Great. Go for it. But at the same time, we don't license stuff that we're not personally interested in. So like someone at Udon isn't interested in. So like a few years back, they asked us if we wanted to do some, the guys who make Five Nights at Freddy's asked us if we wanted to do some books. Mm. And we're like, oh, that's a big property, but none of us know about it. So we'll pass on that. And probably, we could probably put something out and make money, but it's not really something we know about. So I bet someone else would do it better.
Wow. Integrity at a licensing publisher. That's not something you usually find nowadays in the comic industry. It seems like they're just like, yeah, whatever, you know. How crazy could it be, you know? And it feels like a lot of the time people or publishers are licensing various properties and they have almost no knowledge or interest in them. They just figure other people might. And then they do them so wrong. And it doesn't go well. So it seems like you guys have a real good working partnership with the people over at Capcom, and they know obviously what they're doing. So
that helps. Yeah, well, we've been there. We've been working on it a lot longer than most of the people that are there, you know, because some of these companies have a lot of turnover. But when we first got the license, it was just before I worked at Udon, but there was no Capcom USA licensing department. Capcom USA just kind of translated things into English, but so we had to go to Japan to get the Street Fighter license in the first place. Mm. And it was a dead property back then. Like that's what Capcom considered. Like, yeah, they thought they would never do another Street Fighter game, so they're like, sure, do it.
Around what time was this? After 2?
2003, so a couple years after 3.
Oh, okay.
And then there wasn't a new one until 2008 is when Street Fighter 4 came out.
Oh, wow. I had no idea that they had felt that way. It just seems like such a great evergreen property that could be expanded upon in so many ways.
I've told this story before, too, but they told us the reason it took so long to get another game and why they thought like the brand's done is they thought the guys who made Street Fighter 3 thought Street Fighter 3 is perfect. Third Strike is perfect, and whenever anyone would say, let's do Street Fighter 4, it was their response was, how dare you say Street Fighter 3 is not perfect, by suggesting a fourth one. but you know, they changed their mind on that eventually, and they've done some really good games since then. I mean, Street Fighter 6 is great. Oh my gosh, it's so good.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I haven't played since 4, but that's mostly my fault, because I just can't keep up with consoles and games and whatnot, but they look incredible.
They've added in basically a single player like RPG into the game. Like, you make up your own Street Fighter character, whatever you make him look like, whatever you want, and you go around meeting all the different masters and challenging them, and then you learn moves from them. So you mix up moves from different guys to make your character. And it's all set in Metro City, which is the final fight setting. And they just decided, okay, let's make this fun. Metro City's such a hard city that's dealt with so much. Everybody loves fighting. So you can just go up to some old lady on the street and like, let's fight. And they fight and you fight her.
It's like Grand Theft Street Fighter.
Yeah.
That's incredible. Oh, man. We got a question here in the chat from Deimos. It says, a question for Matt. If you do more retro anime licenses, can you work on getting licenses for Mitsa 2? Oh, man, I'm not even going to say that. Yokoyama's mecha and sci-fi manga. Tetsujin 28, Giant Robo, Babel 2, Mars, etc. Man.
It's possible. We are, so not those properties, but we are working on several projects to do with retro anime. So from, I can't really get into specifics, but stuff from the 70s, stuff from the 80s. Some of it is considered 90s stuff here because nobody knew about it in North America to the 90s. But yeah, definitely some retro anime properties. We're going to be doing some projects there. Very nice. I can tell you just recently we did some merch for Battle of the Planets. Well, Gatchaman. We did Gatchaman, the original. So people would know it here as Battle of the Planets.
Yeah, yeah.
So we did some pins for that. You know, we just did pins for Macross, like not the American show, but the actual Japanese Macross, the more recent versions of Macross.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, we're doing all kinds of things with different eras of anime properties.
I don't know how this would work at all, but is there any consideration ever for something like a like something to do with Bubblegum Crisis?
No comment on that. Yeah. That's my answer. No comment.
Okay.
But that was a good question.
All right. Yeah, I always dug that series. I always also wondered this too, and it's feel free again with the no comment thing. But has anyone, to your knowledge, and the chat as well, has there been anyone ever to try to pursue Final Fantasy as a comic?
As a comic?
Or yeah.
I don't think so. I don't think there's not even a lot of, I don't even know offhand about much Final Fantasy manga or anything. So it might just be a tightly controlled thing that they don't want anybody else telling the stories.
It's interesting.
Plus, a lot of those games are, at least the ones that I played, are it's one story, and there's not a lot more to.
Yeah, but yeah.
I mean, you could have them just go on an adventure and fight monsters and stuff, but.
Yeah, you can almost either adapt the game in some kind of official narrative or expound upon it, you know, in some way, shape, or form.
But, yeah, I mean, yeah. So we're kind of lucky to work with Capcom. Like the. Where's the Street Fighter 6 series? So the Street Fighter 6 comics we did are. These guys here are an official prequel to the game. Like our comics are their own universe, but they said they we had this story for like a prequel to the game. It's kind of important to the game. We want people to know it, but we didn't know what we're going to do with it. So do you want to make a comic of it? So we did that. So that's what the 4-issue Street Fighter 6 series was. And it's part of the game continuity officially. And we decided, we looked at it like, oh, there's nothing that contradicts our comics. So let's say this is also a magic intersection point where the game story is the same as the comic story, like exactly.
Mm.
So yeah, we got a chance to actually do something to do with the in-game story there.
The comics usually, are they set up like that where they're kind of a supplemental, where they're considered canon with the games?
Well, our comics, yeah, they're a separate universe. We like to say that we stay true to the characters, but events happen differently. And it's kind of impossible to stay perfectly true to the games because we had our comic universe and then they brought the games back and some characters are alive and they decided we're telling more. Like the games don't go like Street Fighter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They go like 1, 2, 4, 5, 3, 6. Hmm. It's like some of the new games they added in as prequels to other games, and we're like, well, we've already told those games that come after, so in our universe things happen in a different order, I guess, but you know, the big events happen and the characters are the same characters, just different stuff's going on.
Interesting. One thing I meant to ask you last time, and I've been sitting on it for 4 years. Has there has there, and again, I'm really, this is out of my space of expertise, but has there ever been a graphic novel adaptation of the Street Fighter film with Jean-Claude Van Damme?
There was back in the day, like right when it came out. I think Malibu made it. Malibu made a comic series at the time, like an original Street Fighter 2 comic series, and it got canceled. Capcom asked them to please cancel it after 3 issues. Like, please don't make any more. but now I'm trying to think if it was them that did or not. But there was an adaptation of the movie, like, kind of like, do you remember the, it was like a big thick comic, I think. You remember like the big thick adaptation of like the Turtles movies?
They were
big thick books like that.
Kind of like Perfect Bound, but soft cover still.
Yeah. So it was something like that. I haven't read it. I think it's just a direct adaptation. I've been trying to sort out the rights to it for years. It's complicated. I've talked to Universal Pictures. I got to talk to somebody else now. I won't get too much into it, but I had thought that Universal Pictures was the end of the line, and they told us, oh no, you got to talk to these people. Like, oh God. Okay, so I hope to do it one day. I mean, we've done little references to the movie and stuff, but I'd love to do like a sequel set in that universe. Bring back Steven D'Souza, who wrote the movie, right to comics. That'd be great.
Oh, that'd be cool. Yeah, do a sequel. Man, but that'd be cool.
You got to do it just off enough, as the movie was just a little off from the property, and just do a sequel that's also just a little off. I think it'd be great.
That's pretty funny, man. Yeah, I hope you can make that happen. That'd be interesting. So in terms of, I know there's a lot of people out there that are always asking about how to get involved with you guys to work on the comics. How do you recommend that they do that, or if they possibly even can?
Well, writing's tough. We usually work writing-wise with people we know, have known for a long time. So like right now, Chris Saracini is writing some stuff. He's written for us for over a decade, and Kensu Chong has been with us since the beginning. He's working on some stuff. Tim Seeley's working with us now, so he's someone new, but he's a very established writer, so it wasn't hard for him to convince us that he is a good guy to work with. So it's tough on the writing end, but art wise I mean, just ping us on stuff. We have fan art contests once in a while. We do a swimsuit special every year, which is kind of where we test out new artists. So, you know, ping me on Twitter or wherever, like, here's my cool Street Fighter piece. Oh, awesome. And I'll probably, you know, save it and remember it when I'm looking for new artists to try out.
Nice.
But, for comic work, you got to really be in the groove of Street Fighter. Like, we don't really want, I mean, a Jay Lee Street Fighter would be cool, but I don't know if he's in the vibe of the property, you know, kind of a thing.
Yeah.
We try to keep in the very Japanese anime type stuff. We do some other experiments once in a while, but we definitely want like big, fun, exciting artwork.
Yeah, you need that dynamic art. You can't have, I don't think there's a lot of talking head coffee shop stuff going on in the Street
Fighter
comics.
No, it's a rule. Now, Capcom wrote the Street Fighter 6 series, so they broke this rule. But we have a rule that it has to be a fight in every issue. The two characters have to fight.
I don't think that's unreasonable.
Yeah. But we have like a range of stories, you know? Like we have M. Bison's trying to conquer the world, you know, spy end of the world stuff, but we've also got like a hot dog eating contest in the Sakura series, you know, kind of stuff. So there's all kinds of things you can do for Street Fighter. But if you want to get back to art wise, we're just trying to at least stay in the mood of the classic Japanese art, stay somewhere close to there. And some of those guys even do covers for us. Actually, the first issue of the Street Fighter 6 series was drawn by Bengus. I don't know if he's ever drawn a comic before, but it turned out good. But Bengus is a long time, like 30-year character designer at Capcom, and he drew the whole first issue of the Street Fighter 6 comic. That was pretty cool.
Wow, nice, man. So, are there any properties out there that if uh, And again, I don't feel free to always be like, I can't really answer that or whatever else, because I know that you're in a certain situation in some cases. But that you would want to have Udon licensed that aren't necessarily even Capcom affiliated.
Yeah, we're talking to some people about possibilities of some different properties right now. I could tell you some that we're not doing. That I mean, Gargoyles is one of my favorite properties. Dynamite's doing it right now. I haven't read it yet because I'm waiting for the first trade. It's not out yet, but that's a property I love for us to work on sometimes. Maybe we could do some covers or something for it, but that'd be great. Love to do some SNK stuff sometime. I mean, that's the exact same vibe, but that company has it's a complicated history. They've had several owners over, you know, recent years. So it's not something that's easy to just license. But that'd be cool to get that and maybe eventually get like a crossover between the two, just like the Capcom SNK games. So stuff like, if anybody who doesn't know, that's like King of Fighters and Samurai Showdown and stuff like that.
See, Dr. Master, this is going to blow my friend's mind. He didn't even know Street Fighter comics exist.
Well, that's interesting. Yeah, it's hard to get the word out. We learned that at San Diego Comic-Con this year, where we had... So Udon's booth is at the east end of the convention center, and the Capcom booth is at the west end, like the very west end. Like, they're like row one, you know? And that's like... it's like a half mile apart, you know? So... and this year, Capcom asked us, do you want to set up like a satellite booth at the Capcom booth? Because you know, we'd love to have you just selling your Capcom pins and shirts and stuff there. And we're like, okay, we'll try that out. And we didn't bring any of our exclusives there. We just brought like pins from previous years and older shirts and stuff. And people were like, oh my gosh, I can't believe you have an Alex shirt. I'm like, that's 2 years old. You know, like, so there's definitely a crowd that even still just they're Capcom fans, but somehow still don't know us.
But you guys would probably do killer at the video game convention type things, as opposed to even just going to a Comic-Con, even though there's probably definitely a crossover.
Yeah, we're still winding back up, like post-pandemic, of the number of conventions that we do. But this year we did Anime Expo. That's in like, it's in Anaheim or in LA, something like that. I didn't go to that one, but we did San Diego. We're doing we did Otakon, but not quite as Udon. We ran like a booth for the Macross property, just selling Macross stuff, and that might be it for us for conventions this year. In terms of selling stuff, we do other things like trade shows and like book industry shows and stuff like that, but maybe we'll gear up to do some more shows next year.
You know how many shows I do lately, Matt?
How many is that?
I do none.
Oh, it's a grind.
It is. And obviously, yeah, you're in a different position, and Udon's in a different position than I am, and Alterna is. But holy smokes, I feel like I've had my share.
Well, even when like I haven't done for a bit, but when I would do Transformers conventions with my own art, selling prints and stuff, you know, sometimes I do really good. Like, wow, if I did this every weekend, I can make a really good living, and I'd be miserable doing every weekend.
Yeah. It's like, if I did this every weekend and started a coke addiction, then I'd be all set. Everything will be just great for me. Metatron's Cube, I believe you talked about this before, says, have you ever gone to EVO?
We have done a Udon booth at EVO a long time ago, like more than 10 years ago. And it was fine, but now our artists go as, like, just they have their own artist booths. So we just kind of let them get any of the Udon love. You know, people come and get commissions from them or prints and stuff.
And it has to be classic, Eric. Classic.
Yeah, I don't drink diet anything.
Yeah. You're better off just drinking seltzer with like a little bit of, or just flavored seltzer even. as opposed to diet or anything. Diet, the well, diet stuff is
well,
so
now too, there's
bad,
like, there's Diet Coke and Coke Zero, and there's some other kind of Coke
can,
now.
Yeah, can they just make, like, reduced sugar Coke? Like, just cut the sugar in half? How about that? Give that a shot. Regular sugar, no high fructose. Take out the phosphoric acid, you know.
Oh, yeah. Mexican Coke with the real sugar is great.
Yeah.
Canadian Coke is kind of half and half. It's sugar and fructose, so it's okay. But, yeah, I don't like the American Cokes that much.
Yeah, they're running all over the... After a while, it ends up tasting like you've had a lot of, like, sweet corn, you know. You really get that same taste of the corn and the corn syrup. I don't really drink Coke anymore. I don't drink much soda. I drink seltzer, and I put, like, a splash of fruit juice in it. But, yeah, goodness gracious. But something that, that's been on my mind, too, about all this, and again, man, forgive my ignorance if this stuff has come out. I'm not keeping up too much with the Joneses, but it seems like an obvious slam dunk of a thing to have Marvel versus Capcom as a comic. Has that ever happened?
Sort of. There was, like, a tie-in comic when they did a re-release of Marvel vs. Capcom 2, you know, 5 or 6 years ago. They did I don't know how you got it. Maybe if you bought, like, the special edition of the game, something like that. And I think there was a comic that came with Marvel Capcom 3 or Infinite, something like that. So they've done, like, some promo comics, but they haven't done a series. We tried to convince Marvel of it for years, and they're like, no, nobody cares about Street Fighter back then. That was like way a long time ago.
Are those people fired at this point from Marvel?
And you know, it's complicated now. It's Marvel and it's Disney. It's a complicated thing. But we've done stuff. Like we did the Marvel vs. Capcom art book.
That's right, because they don't care about making money anymore.
So we
that's right.
Well, we collected all the art from all the first three games and like the earlier games like Street Fighter, X-Men,
beautiful stuff,
and even the Punisher, basically anything Marvel that Capcom did, we put in an art book. We even got Joe Mad's cover to, which one did he do, Marvel Superheroes, I think he did the cover to. We asked him about it and he's like, no, I don't have a copy of it anymore. And he said, you talk to Tim Townsend, he inked it. And Tim Townsend had a photocopy of the inks. And he sent us that, and it was pretty good. So managed to track down the art from the inker.
Wow. Man, I thought you were going to be like, oh, yeah, we did that, you know, like 10 years ago or whatever. I can't believe that.
We've done art. I mean, we did art for the steelbook of it. We did when Marvel vs. Capcom, which one? I think when Infinite came out, Marvel published a bunch of variant covers, Marvel Capcom variant covers. So, and we, Udon did like half of them, and Marvel people did half of them. So we had like an Udon guy doing Morrigan versus Ghost Rider, stuff like that. So, you know, we got Marvel Capcom onto the cover of comics, but not inside.
Yeah, but. Yeah. Jeez. That's such a miss. I feel like that's such a miss.
I'd still like to do it, but I'd want to use, you know, like 90s characters.
Yes. Yes. Like, yes. Stay true to the game and yeah.
Yeah.
And the costumes therein. Oh, man. What a can of worms it would be today, depending upon how they wanted to do that. But to me, it just seems like a no-brainer. I mean, that's something that. And seriously, you don't have to go into who basically said no.
But, I mean, this is even before. I mean, just before I joined Udon.
Oh wow!
I think we tried even when I was there, but it's a complicated thing to get to do. You know, like you also have to pay double the licensing, right? You got to pay Capcom licensing and Marvel licensing. So that's why, like, when we did the art book, we're like, well, this is like $50 art book. That's fine. We can afford to pay double licensing on that. But yeah, $5 comics is tough. Like, well, ours are already expensive at $5. I think Marvel and DC isn't the average still like $3.99 for both of them.
I don't know. I really don't know. In the chat, you guys might know better than me, although maybe you guys haven't bothered taking a look in quite some time, too. There's definitely books that were sporting like $4.99 and $5.99, and I even saw a couple DCs that were like in the $6.99 territory at one point. but
yeah, there's big like anniversary issues or number ones where they just put more pages and charge more.
Yeah, and it's all relatively pointless anyway. But I don't know. Let's see. Okay, Mark says DC average is $4.99 now. Okay. Yanks is Marvel is $5 to $6. Yeah, I thought that's what I heard. But yeah, that's crazy. I think there's a bunch of people in the chat that would like to see that. But again, yeah, if they can't really make it work, then it really isn't worth it, and there's nothing you could really do about it. Let's see. Ginger says, where does Udon announce art contest? Really enjoying new record of Lodos War, by the way. It takes me back to watching the OVA without recapping the original story.
Cool, yeah. So, well, Lodos War, that's a manga we're publishing right now. This is a 3-volume manga. It's the original writer of the Lodos War manga writing a new story set 100 years later with a new artist. But there's a lot of ties to the original one, and a few characters are still alive, you know, through different means, even 100 years later. So, and it's a 3-volume story, but it's very clear, like, he hopes this to be like the opening arc of a series of stories. So hopefully he gets to do more. But yeah, it's coming out right now. Now for art contests, we'll announce them on our Twitter or our Instagram or our Facebook, like all of them, if they're happening.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah, we haven't done one for a bit. The last one we did was in basically a year ago, so I guess it's time to do one soon.
yeah, keep your eyes out, guys. And what's your Twitter for everybody out there?
Udon Ent, so Udon ENT is most of our social medias.
Okay. We are going to take a quick little break. I see the super chat there. I'm going to get to that as soon as we get back. We're going to show a trailer for just 1 minute. You're watching Comic Book Radio. This is episode 57. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti, and my guest tonight is Matt Moylan of Udon Entertainment. We're going to be right back. Just 1 minute. Don't go anywhere. See you soon.
Entertainment Group presents the Madness Comic Network with original programming and additional comic-related content.
We're back. All right. Deimos, thank you for the super chat. Says, for Matt, if you do more retro licenses, would you do licenses for Yokoyama? Oh, wait.
He asked that.
We asked before. That. You didn't need to. well, I appreciate you sending the super chat, but did you miss the answer?
Well, last time we said I'd not doing those specific properties, but maybe not yet. We'll see.
There you go. Yeah. Appreciate the super chat, but yeah, Matt did answer it in a fuller capacity. If you want to catch the replay or the rewind, you could do that. And Metatron asks, do you guys reprint any of the old Street Fighter Kami mangas that were in Game On magazine?
Yeah, we're looking into. We have done a lot of the Street Fighter mangas some years ago, and we're looking at the license has changed hands in Japan since then. So we're looking at getting the rights back to see if we can do some new editions. We didn't do the Kami manga that came out like maybe even late 90s in North America, we'd love to do. There is a new edition of that in Japan too, so we'd love to add that to our manga. List. I'm not sure who did it way back then.
Yeah, I can't think for the life of me who did.
It could be even somebody wild, like Dark Horse or something. Did you see Dark Horse talking about manga lately?
yeah. They dipped their toe into that years ago, right? And then they kind of,
Well, and they said recently, like manga's something, I forget the numbers, but there's something like manga's like 5% of our effort, but it's like 90% of our sales. Something crazy like that.
I guess you can't beat them, join them.
I mean, we're not that. Maybe if we did more manga, we would be. But, I mean, video game art books is our big income just because of the price, you know? We have the Elden Ring art book coming out in... It's at Barnes & Noble right now. We did an early release with them. You can get it off their website, and if you get it at Barnes & Noble, it comes with, like, this metallic print. It's two, both volumes. There's two volumes for the art book. But the full release, absolutely everywhere, is September 5th. I think that's the Tuesday that week. And so those are... That's two $60 books. So... And it'll be our best-selling book of the year, even before that. So that's doing pretty good. But yeah, definitely video game art books are like the best like effort to income, you know, ratio. Comics are the most effort. It takes so much effort. Even if we're making money, it still takes time.
Yeah, crafting story and all the other original art necessary to get made, everything. Mm-hmm. If you guys want to join the show and ask a question on air, come and do it. There's a link. Questions or comments for Matt. For Matt, not for me, for the guest. Let's see here. We got another question. Alpha Proto asks, is there a difference between a license to publish an art book and a license to make a narrative graphic book? Udon has licenses to do a lot of interesting art books that could be cool comics.
Yeah, for sure. Most of our art books are translated from Japan. We do some original art books. Like, we've done original ones, like, except for Marvel Capcom and for, we've done Darksiders, we've done Robotech, like, so they're books where the licensor gives us all the art and, we put it together and arrange it and lay it out and stuff. So those are still in the, in most cases, they're giving us existing artwork. So we're not creating a bunch of artwork. Sometimes we're creating text content. Sometimes they'll let us do like a bonus gallery of like, say tribute artwork to the property. But yeah, we're not doing much narratively, so it's definitely a different license, and the licensor has to be interested in someone else working on their property. Some licenses, they don't even want you to do a new art. Like, there was a big anime property that we used to do these tribute art books where we'd basically hold a giant art contest. Like, we did one for Mega Man, an art contest, and we'll pick the best 200 or 300 entries and put them into an art book, and we got like 3,000 entries for that. And you know, we don't pay people, but for that we give you the right to do an officially licensed print based off of your artwork. So it's not like it's not fan art anymore. Like, this is official, has copyright on it and stuff. So that's how the artists in the book, you know, get to make a few bucks off of being in this book. But anyway, we pitched that idea to like an anime property, and they said no, we don't want our characters existing in different styles. So yeah, sometimes they don't want anything being created by other people, but you know, it's sometimes it works out. Yeah, so it's definitely two different kinds of licenses.
Yeah, that kind of even seems like that's been the key to some of their success in terms of having that streamlined look and feel.
You know? Even if you just go to like a manga property, there's usually only one or two creators, like maybe just one creator or maybe a separate writer and artist sometimes, but there's a pretty unified vision for a lot of properties. It's one of the reasons too that manga does so well, because of the media tie-ins, like the anime tie-ins. So you watch, say, Attack on Titan. A lot of people see the anime first and like, oh, I want to get the manga, and you read the manga and like, oh, this is the same story, cool, this is just a but there's little differences and different pacing and stuff. So anime really helps manga sell, but it's not really the case for other things like most comic books. There is for a few things, like Invincible is pretty much just like the comic. Walking Dead, kind of like the comic, started out like the comic.
And then it like derails completely.
But other stuff though, like the Thor movies aren't getting people into the Thor comics, you know? Like, what do you... You go watch the first Thor movie, what do you... someone comes in like, oh, I just saw the Thor movie. I want to read the comics. What do you give them? Like, oh, here's the first Thor comics. Oh, here's the current Thor comic.
Here's Walt Simonson's run. Yeah. Have fun with it. And then, you know, don't look back. That's it. That's all the Thor there is. Don't even pay attention to whatever else. Yeah, there's not a lot of synergy going on, you know, and I think that's why they're not experiencing the same kind of thing that the anime manga kind of thing has going for it. Even with licensing comics, like back in the day when they were doing a lot of licensing between Marvel and DC, they put some top-rate talent on there. The books look just as good as their other books looked. And they stayed pretty consistent with characterization and story. And then now when you see a lot of stuff, regardless of who it is in terms of licensing, I mean, most of the times now when I see a licensed comic, you know, maybe there's a good-looking cover, but then you open up the story and it's just it's a mess. The lettering is even horrible. Like, they can't even get a decent letterer. You know, it's so strange. That's why you guys obviously have a great formula for what you're doing. You got an eye for talent, and you got good standards there, and Capcom obviously does too. But, I mean, why do you think that is with some of these licensed comics that are going on with other publishers where it seems like the wheels just fall off the cart?
I don't know. They just don't want to put the money into it to get the top talent, or they think it's not worth it. I mean, there's overall been like a talent vacuum in comics for a long time. There's always going to be great creators, but like most of the great artists now, like the young guys, they're probably not going to go into comics. They're going to go, I want to be a video game concept artist, or I want to be work in animation or something. Whereas it used to be like, oh, I love these, you know, like all the 90s guys were guys who loved the 80s comics, you know, like, and they want to get into comics. And now those people are, you know, going to, even the guys like Joe Madd, who's, you know, 90s comic artist, he doesn't really do comics now, he does video games. So it's just that the talent, there's not such a big talent pool in the industry anymore.
Yeah, I guess so. it's hard for me to, and I get where you're coming from too, because the publishers out there, it's a
feedback cycle too, that you don't, oh, we don't put the effort into this, and then it sells less, and then we can't afford to put the money into the next project. And
yeah, and it turns into this false economy where they're like, let's hire as cheaply as possible and you know, maximize profits or whatever it may be, but then the profits don't really come in because you cut off the legs right from the start. So you're not really, I mean, you're cutting corners right at the start of it. So then therefore, where's the profit going to be, because you're putting out a substandard product? It might work the first time, or it might work with the bait and switch if you get a really great cover artist, but then the interior or the story is substandard. But I think I definitely understand in terms of the talent pool and whatnot. But then I look around at the indie scene. And I mean, I know, and I'm not going to dive into it tonight. I know what's going on in the industry in terms of what's happening with the mainstream and the indie and most creators that want to get involved in comics, but are like, yeah, there's no way I'm working for the big two or whatever mainstream comic company for various reasons. But it's interesting to me to look at that, because at the end of the day, it should always be about the story and the characters and the quality of that. And you guys, it's great to hear you guys having integrity about those things, even though like you're doing licensed comics. You know, you would think that, because there's so many others out there that they just throw it all at the wall, you know, we'll license whatever that might sell, and that'll be that. You know, we won't put too much effort into the talent, into whether or not we care about it, it doesn't matter. But that you guys do, it's great, and it shows. And I think that's why you guys are experiencing the success too that you have.
You're interested in it, then you can get excited about it. You can get excited about selling it. You
know, yeah.
The creators will get excited about telling people, I worked on this. I finally got to do a Street Fighter story, or I did a cover, you know? So if you get the people who want to do it, then
absolutely,
it's just going to profit benefit you down the line.
Let's see, Alpha was asking, so no Samurai Pizza Cats comics. I love Samurai Pizza Cats.
Samurai Pizza Cats, this.
Oh man.
But well, we do, we have Samurai Pizza Cats merchandise licensing. We translated the art book. That'd be cool. I love that show. I don't know if it would sell. there's a, it's one of those things that there's a small devoted audience. So I don't know if we could sell them a lot of comics. I mean, maybe like a mini series or something.
That'd be cool.
Yeah, there's a lot of the books that we publish. Some of them have like not big audiences, but if we can do a $50 or $60 art book for a small audience, then that's fine. Stuff like our best selling art book outside of the Dark Souls, Bloodborne, Elden Ring sort of spiritual trilogy of franchises. Outside of that, our best selling art book ever is Okami, just like a video game that only had one. I only had two games at a PS2 game and a DS game, and that's it. And this art book is only for the PS2 game, and it's, you know, we reprint it every year or every other year, just because that small audience, anybody who's played that game loves the game and will buy the book. So.
Yeah, that's great, man. Let's see here. Where is this? There it is. Brian, yeah, I don't recommend many. And you guys know me, I don't often preach anything about licensed comics. I usually talk about creator-owned. But Udon is consistently putting out quality stuff. And Matt's a good dude, and it shows. Just go check out some Udon books, and you'll see. It's good stuff.
If you want to try out something for the first time, I'd recommend Street Fighter Origins Sagat, which is an original graphic novel we released earlier this year by Chris Arcini and Joe Ng, and it's like the story of a young Sagat, and we wanted to show how it was tough, because we know this character starts in the games as a dark character and kind of becomes not a good guy but not so much of a bad guy, at least, but so we wanted to see like how could someone who's got some good in him turn to the dark side, I guess. But it's really great, like old school martial arts story of a young Sagat and other characters when they were younger, some of the characters' masters when they were younger. And you don't have to know anything about Street Fighter to just enjoy this story.
Nice. So. Yeah, go check that out. I don't know. There was an explosion noise over by me. I don't know if you guys even heard it through my mic, but that was weird. Hopefully everything's okay. Something else I wanted to ask you, this is a turn completely away from Udon. Aside from this stuff, aside from working as director of publishing, what else are you up to? What else are you doing?
What am I working on?
Yeah.
No, I help a lot of friends with the pre-press for their books, or sometimes like lettering and stuff, just if it's like a friend and a property I want to be involved with. So I did the lettering for Clownfish TV's Crimson Wren book, and the pre-press for that book.
Oh, nice. I just had Neon on the show Sunday.
Yeah. So that was a fun thing to get to work with Neon. But otherwise, nothing I'm working on that I can announce. I mean, I play a lot of board games, stuff like that. I write comics for Pixie Trick Comics. They're Giselle Lagasse's company, and I've done four, it's only once a year, but I've done four issues of a series called Carmen Camellia, which is a, so what Pixie Tricks is Giselle's, she does web comics, and they're kind of, you know, funny. It's like the mood of Archie Comics if everyone was also sleeping with everybody else. So they're kind of fun, lewd comics, and in this universe there's a comic shop that makes their own comics, so I wrote one of the comics that's in the universe.
Nice.
It's like a color comic series, so it's about a space bounty hunter who has the ability to copy the powers of aliens or materials around her, but only for 60 seconds at a time. So she can like, oh, I'm fighting this alien, I need like some metal, I've got to touch some metal and be metal, and I've got to fight them in the next 60 seconds, that kind of stuff. So it's a fun series.
That's cool, man. Nice. Good to hear that. Let's see. Norn is asking, who's your main in Street Fighter 2? Is this Ken?
Well, this is my intro to the Street Fighter encyclopedia that I wrote. So how much I know about Street Fighter, I wrote the encyclopedia, but my intro says I always pick Ryu because I'm not very good at the Street Fighter games. But I use Ryu for everything. Although I really like Juri in the new game. She's fun. I mean, she's been fun since she appeared. Ever since she appeared. But yeah, if I old school Street Fighter, I'd pick Ryu. I really don't know how to do charging. I still don't get it. So any charge moves. So I can't play like Guile or something. But
yeah. I always went for Vega. Just because I think it's the he reminds me of Wolverine with the claw on the hand. But yeah. I was never good at those games, though, man. I was just like, if I won, it was just sheer luck. Just
well, I played Street Fighter 2 on the PC, is how I first played it.
Oh, wow.
We had it, me and my brother, and we would play. We didn't have a computer controller, so we'd play on opposite ends of the keyboard. Like, you'd have controls on one end, and he'd have controls on the other end, and we wore out the space bar using Dalsim, I think it was, maybe. Mm. Dalsim, or using E Honda, who his move is, you know, 100 hand slap is just hit attack over and over. So we wore out the space bar on a keyboard and had to get a new keyboard from Street Fighter on computer.
I did the first time I played Street Fighter was Super Nintendo, and then I played in the arcades, and it was so great in the arcade. But man, that thing would eat quarters. yeah, I loved Blanca and
Blanca is super popular.
Yeah.
I got to write our Street Fighter Masters Blanca one shot a couple years ago, which was a story I had in mind for years. Was like a silent story that starred Blanca. So that was our free comic book day book about 2 years ago.
Wow, man. Let's see. Everyone's saying who they're using here. Chun-Li. They figured out the walking Blanca role. Man, oh man. Yeah, I like playing those games, but man, I could never figure out moves, and if I did, it was always like, how'd I do that? I have no idea. I just hit whatever the hell there was to hit. It was easier with Mortal Kombat for me figuring out some moves. It was usually just like diagonal something or other and a button, or like take two steps and hit a button.
It's kind of why the new game is great, as you earn like, I forget what they call it, but you earn like reputation with each master, like each Street Fighter character, and yet by using their moves. So it encourages you to change up the moves and try different people's moves during the single player campaign.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Yeah, Virtua Fighter, man, holy smokes, that takes me back. Goodness gracious. Let's see. Deimos says, random question. I'm new to the streams, Pete, but when do you read super chats? If it
that's super chat then.
Deimos, I read your question twice. Where are you? I read your question all the way up when you first asked it. Where is it here? Yeah, when it was here at 9:16 and we originally had answered it. And I deeply appreciate you sending it as a super chat, but then we kind of answered it again. Are you with us live? I appreciate you being here, but he's dealing with family drama. Rest assured, we got to your question twice, and I recommend checking out the live replay of the show after that. And yeah, Matt answered your question. Don't you worry. Appreciate it though. Thank you. So before you go, because we're gonna wrap up in about a minute or so. Is there anything you wanted to give a shout out to? Anything you want to give in response to what you're seeing out there in terms of the creators that maybe want to pick up some work at Udon?
Just if you want to work at Udon, if you want to work on Street Fighter, you got to love Street Fighter for sure. You've got to be interested in it. But that's really it. I'd love to plug a book that we've got coming up. We're doing a book called Team Phoenix, which is it's a manga that we're translating from Japan, and it is all the characters of Osamu Tezuka in one universe. So reimagined as like a space adventure. So it's got Astro Boy in it. It's got Jungle Emperor Leo. It's got Sapphire Knight. All kinds of other characters. Blackjack is in it. So just imagine them all in like one universe. And it's kind of cool because they reverse the themes of Astro Boy is one of their main themes, whereas Astro Boy is all about like robot rights, on Earth. So this is a universe 90% controlled by robots, and the humans are fighting for their rights in this robot universe. So the first volume of that, it's by it's a Japanese manga, but they hired a Spanish artist, Kenny Ruiz, to draw it. So
I'm pretty sure I've heard of him. I've seen his stuff.
Yeah, so the first volume's coming out in November, and it's only 5 volumes, so it's not a long series compared to many other manga. So I'd like a lot of people to check that out, because we've finished the first 2 volumes so far in production, and they're both great. So yeah, check that series out.
Nice, man. Deimos asks, will we get Ambassador Magma?
Maybe. I won't spoil. There's a lot of reveals. What do you call them? The seven greatest robots. I think they're called 7 greatest robots on Earth. I forget exactly what they're called, but most of them are in it. But there are many characters. Even the title Team Phoenix will give you a hint to, you know, someone else who might be in it.
There you go. And lastly, this might be a few minutes, but you can answer this as long or as short as you want. What do you see the comic industry being like within the next 5 years?
Well, it's going to be interesting to see what happens. Some of the big companies of Marvel and DC are kind of post-profit companies, and making money is not necessarily their goal. It might be IP development, it might be other things, but they're not super concerned, like everything has to make $1 million. Now we'll see if that changes now that everyone's tightening their belts, like the parent companies. But we'll see what happens if they just publish fewer books, if they start licensing out books. But I definitely think there'll be nostalgia for good comics. Like they're already getting there. Like something like some people may like them, but you know, I'm not a big fan of the IDW Ninja Turtles comics. Maybe some other people like them, but they did Last Ronin recently, and that's just great. It's amazing. It's just a fun comic. So that's doing amazing for them. So I hope that that they and other publishers sort of take that to heart. If you just do something that's fun and high quality,
you figure it's there's too many people trying to reinvent the wheel, right? And instead of just making a good, solid, fun story that can be enjoyed.
Yeah, X-Men. I want the X-Men to hang out at a mansion, and I want the Juggernaut to break through the door sometimes, and they get in a fight with them, and, oh, we've got to go take care of, I don't know, Magneto and the Brotherhood are doing something, or there's something happening with Sentinels. You know, I just want them to be superheroes again.
Yeah, yeah. It's not too much to ask, I think.
Yeah. But otherwise, I mean, there's a lot going on at Diamond right now. We'll see what happens there. I mean, Diamond also has a lot of diverse parts of the company. Like, they have the books part, and they have the comics part, and they have toys, board games. So there's a lot happening there. I mean, we're still exclusive to Diamond. We, in the past, did have one brief, like, flirtation with another distributor for books, and it really didn't work out. So we went back to Diamond. But I don't think we're going to be changing anytime soon. It might be because we're a small company, but they give us a lot of attention, especially, and they've been really helpful getting, we've done a lot of Barnes & Noble exclusive covers lately, and that's all Diamond helping us set those up. So that's been really great.
You're lucky, man. You're lucky. Well, thank you so much, Matt. You guys are doing a great job over there at Udon. This is a good question too. I'll throw this at you before we wrap it up. Let's see. Does Udon get a Capcom Street Fighter style guide, or do you guys have to make your own?
We do have a style guide. Now we don't get the style guide always right away. Like we have a Street Fighter 4 style guide and a Street Fighter 5. And they're like, so the Street Fighter 4 one was just like kind of front and back character designs and all the Pantone colors, you know, if you're going to be making merch, exactly what inks to use and stuff. The Street Fighter 5 one is nice, detailed, like turnarounds of every character and zoom ins of every character, like in their main costume, like you know, their belt buckle looks like this and their shoe looks like this on the bottom. So that's great. Now they're still slowly building their Street Fighter VI style guide, but they provide us like character designs for most of the main characters. And even though it's not in a formal style guide yet, we'll eventually get there as they build up the game. But yeah, and honestly, recently Capcom has been more strict about the character designs. And it's not that we were off before, but historically, a lot of the characters have inconsistent character designs from different artists and in different games. So like Chun-Li and a different piece of artwork might have 8 spikes on her bracelet, or she might have 6 on another artwork. And Capcom has been really big lately on saying, let's standardize everything. Chun-Li's bracelets look like this. She has this many hair ribbons. So even though, you know, yeah, we know you've seen other art that's not accurate like this, but they've decided this is going to be the standard for her classic costume. They've done the same with Darkstalkers. This is going to be the standard for Morrigan, this for Felicia. So that's been good lately. I mean, sometimes they're a little strict, like, nope, you gotta be this many ribbons. We can't see the 4th ribbon. Like, okay, fine. Add it in. But no, it's cool that we have like exact guidelines nowadays.
It's gotta be helpful too. You know, as much as that seems like it's a little bit maybe restrictive at times, perhaps, but it's gotta be helpful, and it's their thing. They know what they want it to look like. So,
yeah.
Yeah. No problem at all, Deimos. Don't worry about it. I hope you actually go back and check out the answer too. And thank you guys so much for watching the stream tonight. It was a good one with Matt here, and I promise it won't be 3 to 4 years for the next one. Maybe we'll do like an annual checkup, and then we can we don't have to have so much to catch up on, and then we can dive into more current situations as opposed to like what's been going on in the past 4 years. Everybody, really appreciate it. And before we do go, I just want to give a shout out to you guys also in the chat, and maybe they're watching later. The King Cryptid campaign, which is on both Indiegogo and AlternaComics.com, we're over 500 backers, so you guys get another physical perk bonus for those that are physical perk backers. And we are very close to 22,000 overall. We're just 74 away. And we crossed the $10,000 milestone on Indiegogo on that portion of the campaign as well earlier today. Thank you guys so much for your support. This is to fund issues 5 to 9. And 1 to 4 are available right now. So go pick them up on AlternaComics.com or get a catch-up tier and get issues 1 to 9 on the campaign. But thank you guys so very much for your support on that campaign. And I'm all done with Alterna Fulfillment for the winter campaign. We're moving forward now with getting things ready to fulfill for the August/September campaign, so we can get that into your hands as soon as possible. Thank you guys for your support on that too. Everybody have a wonderful night. I'll be back. Let me check the schedule here. Tomorrow night with Mike Murphy and Selena. I'll be talking with them. I'll be back here at 9:00 Eastern tomorrow. And that should be a fun show too. Matt, thank you so much, man, for joining me tonight and being on here. Really good time talking to you. And all the best of luck with everything going on over there.
Awesome, dude. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no problem. Everyone, take it easy. Have a great night. And I'll see you guys tomorrow.